And I would be talking to you about the workup of a case of microbial keratitis as well as bacterial keratitis. So to talk about bacterial keratitis, I have no financial interests or disclosures, and this is how a case of bacterial keratitis would look like. This is a classical case of Pseudomonas bacterial keratitis. And the risk factors for bacterial keratitis could be ocular, could be systemic. The ocular risk factors are such as corneal abrasion or epithelial defect, eyelid disease, contact lens use, previous ocular surgery, ocular surface disease, compromised corneas, and injudicious use of topical antibiotics, steroids, and traditional eye medicine. And there could be systemic risk factors, which include use of immunosuppressive drugs, burns, chronic alcoholism, severe malnutrition, AIDS, malignancy, rheumatoid arthritis, and extremes of age. Extremes of age meaning infancy and old age. This is a case of keratitis in a diabetic patient, and this is a case of keratitis in rheumatoid arthritis, which tends to be peripheral. Now, apart from this, there could be other causes, such as use of traditional eye medicine or honey, which is common in some of the rural areas. Then post-LASIK keratitis, you can see the flap and a buttonhole flap with the microbial keratitis, and then thinning and perforation, which can occur when topical steroids are used in cases injudiciously. The symptoms, of course, we all are aware of: redness, sensitivity to light, which is increased, or photophobia, decreased visual acuity, pain, discharge, and associated conjunctivitis. And this occurs more often when the organism is gonococci, pneumococci, and haemophilus. So whenever a case of microbial keratitis comes, howsoever small or large it may be, it is important to do a good slit lamp evaluation and to do fluorescein staining. So this is mainly to know the area and the density of infiltration, the size and depth of ulceration, the size of the epithelial defect, the degree of the stromal edema, and the scleral involvement, and anterior chamber reaction. So this is actually the size of the epithelial defect, which is staining, and the size of the infiltration is here larger than the size of the epithelial defect. So each time the patient comes, you have to monitor not only the epithelial defect, but also the size of the infiltration. And when the patient changes the position, then you can see that there is a change in the hypopyon, and this hypopyon is of course mobile, and static hypopyon is more often seen in cases of fungal keratitis. Now, important to know what is the grade of the ulcer, whether it is mild, moderate, or severe, and if it is less than 2 millimeters in size, 20% depth, superficial, then it is mild, then 2 to 5, 20 to 50%, mid stroma, then it is moderate, and if it is more than 5, more than 50% depth, deeper than stroma, then it is severe. Now this is how it would look like. It is important because that would dictate your treatment modality, whether it is bacterial keratitis or it is fungal keratitis. Now, generally, it is seen that ulcers with a poor outcome are more likely to be larger, and they involve posterior cornea and have aspergillus species, or they occur in females. This is a study which just looked at the risk factors for severe microbial keratitis. Now, most of the times, you can, at least 70% of the times, pick up what the organism is. So if it's a punched out lesion like this with clear margins, with cornea which is surrounding, which is relatively clear, then most likely it is staphylococcus. And the non-edematous surrounding cornea would be there. However, if it is an ulcer like this, which is rapidly progressive, serpiginous ulcer with folds, which desmoid membrane folds, a hypopyon, and deep stromal abscess, then it is most likely to be pneumococcal. However, if it has a ground glass stromal appearance, is fulminant, greenish yellow discharge, infiltration occurs in 24 hours, ring ulcer in 48 hours, and there's within 2 to 5 days there is desmatocele or perforation, then it is most likely to be a Pseudomonas ulcer. Mycobacteria ulcers, on the other hand, have this cracked windshield-like appearance with surrounding cornea, which is quite clear. It occurs following trauma, and it is generally indolent, and there's hardly any IC reaction. You can see again this cracked windshield-like appearance. Moraxella ulcers, on the other hand, they tend to be inferior, they tend to be oval, there's hardly any IC reaction, and the rest of the cornea is quite clear, and it is seen more in diabetics, alcoholics, and malnourished. Nucardia is like a flower-like pattern, so wreath pattern with satellite lesions and ulcers which are indolent with elevated hyphate edges and cracked windshield appearance. Now, the limitations of the clinical evaluation is that you can pick it up only 3/4 of the times or 76% of the times. You may still require microbiology for in 1/3 of the cases. Now, having said that, if the ulcer is not responding to treatment, it is always best to do microbiology. Now, corneal scrapes are the ones which need to be done, which are the mainstay for any case of microbial keratitis. Proparacaine should be used, which is least bactericidal, and the scraping should be done from the leading edge of the ulcer as well as from the center of the ulcer. And we generally like to use a 15-degree blade, although modified Kimura spatula is what has been recommended. And the most important stains for a case of bacterial keratitis, or for that matter for any microbial keratitis, is KOH, because that will immediately tell you whether you have to start your antifungal therapy or not. And apart from this, you do Gram stain, and in cases which are recalcitrant, you do acid fast. Acid fast is done for man. Man means mycobacteria, actinomyces, and nucardia. So whenever you are suspecting man, mycobacteria, actinomyces, or nucardia, you would do acid fast stain. Now, the standard culture media which is generally used is blood agar, and also chocolate agar, and in cases of fungus, if you're suspecting fungus, always send for Sebrard's dextrose agar. And in cases of recalcitrant infections, for LJ media, for mycobacteria, and non-nutrient agar with E. coli for acanthamoeba. Then culture positivity rate for bacterial keratitis is 40% to 73%, and everything that is related to the ulcer, which includes a suture, a contact lens solution, or contact lens case, everything should be sent for culture and sensitivity. And sometimes you have interface infections like this, then you need to actually remove these sutures and send a scrape from there. And at other times you may have infectious crystalline keratopathy, and again, after LASIK, and then you have to elevate this flap and take a scrape from there. If you may have infections after DSEC, then in those cases you have to use intravitreal intravitreal scissors to take a biopsy from the posterior lenticule if the infection is there. And sometimes you have corneal abscess where there is no epithelial defect. Then you can do a short suture biopsy, that is, you take a needle with a very short suture, pass it through this abscess and send it for culture sensitivity. Corneal biopsy is indicated in cases which are at least twice negative. For smear and culture, there's no clinical improvement, so you can do partial thickness trepidation. The tissue is removed, end block, bisected, and sent for culture sensitivity. Then in mild ulcers, which are less than 3 millimeters in size, not involving the visual axis, monotherapy should be used, which could be a fourth generation fluoroquinolone, such as a gatifloxacin or moxifloxacin. However, in moderate ulcers, which are more than 3 millimeters in size and involving the visual axis, combination therapy is used with fortified kefosiline 5% and tobramycin 1.3% to cover for gram-positive cocci and the gram-negative bacilli. Now, bacterial keratitis, you have to give loading dose. A loading dose is generally given for 48 hours, round the clock for initial 48 hours, and then you assess the clinical response. So if it is a fungal keratitis, you would give loading dose for up to 4 days and then assess the clinical response. Bacterial keratitis, if it starts to improve, would generally improve within the next 2 to 3 weeks, whereas fungal keratitis would take ordinarily 3 to 4 weeks to respond. And when you say round the clock, you mean even during the bedtime, even if the patient has to wake up and put these drops. So these are just two randomized controlled studies wherein we compared monotherapy versus the combination therapy in mild to moderate ulcers, and we found that both of them were equivalent. Another randomized controlled trial in more than 200 plus patients where we found similarly. Adjuvant therapy has to be used, which includes cycloplegics, anti-glaucoma medications, and topical steroids, which I would be telling you when to use them. And systemic antibiotics, we do prefer for cases of perforation, post-perforating injury, scleral involvement, and when the organism is Neisseria or Haemophilus. The SCUT trial, or the steroids for corneal ulcer trials, did look at the role of the steroids in cases of bacterial keratitis, and it did tell us that early use of topical steroids is beneficial when the vision is low, or when the ulcers are central, or when they are deep. And non-nocardia keratitis, severe Pseudomonas keratitis, did better with topical steroids. So in short, topical steroids should never be used in cases of fungal keratitis, atypical mycobacteria keratitis, and nocardia keratitis. topical steroids in bacterial keratitis can be used provided you have a culture sensitivity report in hand and provided you've already loaded the bacterial keratitis at least for 48 hours with the antibacterials. Now, the favorable signs are that there will be decrease in the area density of infiltration and there will be epithelial healing, decrease AC reaction. Unfavorable signs would be when there are other organisms and other factors which are responsible for it. Now, modify antibiotics only if there is no clinical improvement. And if there is, and taper, in fact, you should stop short the antibiotics when there are clinical signs of improvement. Now, if your culture sensitivity report says otherwise, but clinically the patient is improving, change nothing about it, because that is the best test of whether the patient is responding or not responding. In recalcitrant keratitis, when the organisms are MRSA, use vancomycin 5%, severe Pseudomonas keratitis, ceftazidime, Mycobacterium fortitum or chelone, and Nocardia, amikacin can also be used. Now, these are the ways to present, to prepare the kefazolin in your clinics or in your pharmacies, and tobramycin, the concentrated drops, 5% and 1.3% respectively. And this is how you would prepare the fortified drops, vancomycin 5% and trimethoprim or sulfamethoxazole drops, the concentration of which is 16 mg and 80 mg per ml respectively. Topical colistin 0.19% has been used for cases which are resistant to everything. And again, injection colistin is available and this can again be diluted to prepare 0.19% solution. Is useful in those cases where the bacterial keratitis is resistant to all the commonly available antibacterials. This is how the healing of the corneal ulcer should be over a period of time when the ulcer converts into a scar, and the end point is that you want the scar to be less hazy, and there should be hardly any opacification when the ulcer actually heals. Now, sometimes there can be compliance issues. This ulcer was healing when the antibacterials were started, but as the patient stopped to take these antibacterials, again there is increase in the hypopyonic size of the ulcer. Of course, you can have sequel and complications such as this, perforations, thinning, adherent glaucomas, when these need to be addressed by other surgical methods of treatment for microbial keratitis. And when there's impending perforation, then one can use glue. When there is a perforation, then one can use patch graft, which could be lamellar or full thickness penetrating keratoplasty. And when there is no response, then of course to reduce the microbial load, one can do a therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty. So to conclude, early diagnosis and meticulous treatment are mandatory in cases of bacterial keratitis. Compliance and resistance are important issues in event of non-resolution. Antibacterials should be used judiciously and surgery may be required in recalcitrant cases. So thank you.